Good morning and welcome to our second in-church service. It's wonderful to see some of you out here on this supremely hot day again. I'd like to introduce our worship team this morning. Anne is on the piano sharing her music ministry with us, the lovely Nancy, our soloist and lay reader, because we can't have too many people up here. And of course, in the technical booth, we have Steve and Bill, who are hopefully, are we running live? We're not running live, sort of. I'm not sure. The answer is no, definite this. Okay. So we're not running live, but they're recording it for later on for those of you out there who wish to watch the service. We have one special joy that came in this morning. Today is Marianne and Larry's 51st wedding anniversary. Congratulations. Wow. So I can say Marianne, wow. Just kidding, Larry. I would like to bring up Melanie for a little bit of an announcement.
I get to do this in person. So good morning, everybody, and I am so happy to see everybody here today, too. I am so fortunate today to be able to be here and to welcome our new minister to this service. After an extensive search, we have finally reached a culmination to this part of our journey. I have words from a piece of music. Alan did sing this a couple months ago, written by Mendelssohn, and it says, "O rest in the Lord, wait patiently for him, and he will grant you thy heart's desires. O rest in the Lord." We waited, and we're here. So today, as chair of the search committee, I have the pleasure of introducing and welcoming Reverend Young Sok Bak, his spouse Eugene Oh, and their daughters Sol and Dana to our church family and community. I'm sure that you are as thrilled as I am that they are here today to worship with us and to begin our faith journey with us. And officially next week on September 1st, he will be our minister. So welcome. Thank you for coming.
Thank you, Melanie, and welcome. I look forward to it and the rest, so I can sit out there too. As light comes from this candle, may the blessing of Jesus Christ come to us, warming our hearts and brightening our way. Let us join together in the invitation to worship. We are not here, O God, to be preoccupied with our own needs,
but to offer you our thanks and praise.
We are not here, O God, to prove our own faithfulness,
but to think carefully about how we may proclaim the good news.
We are not here, O God, to put right what cannot be changed,
but to reflect on the possibilities before us for wholeness and healing.
We are not here, O God, to dwell on our own shortcomings,
but to remember your love for us in Jesus Christ and renew our discipleship in him.
Let's sing our first hymn, number 509, I, the Lord of Sea and Sky.
Stars of night, I will make
Let us pray together, saying, Holy God, we give thanks that you have gathered us here together this morning. We give thanks that you welcome us with our fears and our dreams and embrace us with your healing love. Open our ears that we may hear your word. Open our mouths that we may speak your truth. Open our hands that we might do your will. For we long to be your people in our words and deeds. In Jesus' name, amen.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. From the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and
our first lesson this morning, and I like the fact that Christine has labeled it as wisdom literature, being the teacher, is from Proverbs, and I'm reading selected verses. A good name is more desirable than good riches. To be esteemed is better than silver or gold. Rich and poor have this in common: the Lord is maker of them all. Whoever sows injustice reaps calamity, and the rod they wield in fury will be broken. The generous will themselves be blessed, for they share their food with the poor. Do not exploit the poor because they are poor, and do not crush the needy in court. For the Lord will take up their case and will exact life for life. The end of our lesson.
Thank you, Nancy. Our gospel lesson this morning is taken from Mark chapter 7, verses 24 to 37. Jesus left that place and went to the vicinity of Tyre. He entered a house and did not want anyone to know it, yet he could not keep his presence secret. In fact, as soon as she heard him, a woman whose little daughter was possessed by an impure spirit came and fell at his feet. The woman was a Greek, born in Syrian Phoenicia. She begged Jesus to drive the demon out of her daughter. First, let the children eat all they want, he told her, for it is not right to take the children's bread and toss it to the dogs. Lord, she replied, even the dogs under the table eat the children's crumbs. Then he told her, "For such a reply, you may go. The demon has left your daughter." She went home and found her child lying on the bed, and the demon was gone. Then Jesus left the vicinity of Tyre and went through Sidon, down to the Sea of Galilee, and into the region of Decapolis. There some people brought him to a man who was deaf and could hardly talk, and they begged Jesus to place his hand on him. After he took him aside away from the crowd, Jesus put his fingers into the man's ears. Then he spit and touched the man's tongue. He looked up to heaven and with a deep sigh said to him, "Ephphatha," which means "be opened." At this, the man's ears were opened and his tongue was loosened, and he began to speak plainly. Jesus commanded them not to tell anyone, but the more he did so, the more they kept talking about it. People were overwhelmed with amazement. "He has done everything well," they said. "He even makes the deaf hear and the mute speak." Thus ends this portion of Holy Scripture. May God bless it to our understanding.
Just want to make a comment before I start singing. It's been a real privilege to be part of the music ministry while we were worshiping from afar together. And last week, as I sat in the pew and heard the sounds of my fellow congregants around me, I cried. So thank you that we are here together as we continue our worship ministry. Why should I feel discouraged? Why should the shadows come? Why should my heart be lonely and long for heaven and home? When Jesus is my portion, my constant friend is he. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. Let not your heart be troubled. His tender word I hear, and resting on his goodness, I lose my doubt and fears. Though by the path he leadeth, but one step I may see, his eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. I sing because I'm happy. I sing because I'm free. For his eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. Tempted, whenever clouds arise, when songs give place to sighing, when hope within me dies, I draw the closer to him. From care he sets me free. and I know He watches me.
Thank you, Nancy. Thank you, Anne. That was beautiful. Let us pray. Oh God, make us ready to hear the words spoken to our hearts this morning. Call us to hear your wisdom and grant us the courage to respond. Amen. So you wake up with a start, realizing something seems not quite right. You look at the alarm clock and it's blank. Oh no, it's broken. You jump out of bed and turn on the light. It doesn't go on. So you try it again. And then again. Because as we all know, if you keep trying, eventually it'll work. Until it hits you. Oh, it's a blackout. Then, oh no, what time is it? You grab your cell phone and, phew, at least your internal clock is working. So you trudge to the bathroom, stubbing your toe on the door jamb, shower in the dark, get dressed in the dark, brush your teeth in the dark. Oh, if only you had listened to your mother and had some emergency candles on hand. Not thinking, you head straight for the coffee pot. Drat, blackout. Well, time for Timmy's for breakfast. As you drive, you realize that people don't know how to drive in an intersection when the lights are out. In your head, you scream, treat it like a four-way stop. Mumble, mumble, mumble. Finally, Timmy's closed. Drat, blackout. As you head to work, you see that you're now in an area that has power. Thank you, God. Timmy's around almost every corner. After all, we are in Canada, eh? Looks like everyone else had the same idea. The lineup is on the street and around the corner. Gotta get that coffee. As you wait, you think about taking that first sip of steaming, fresh coffee. Finally, it's your turn. A double and a bagel. That'll hit the spot. You head for the canal and just about make it. The bridge goes up. Great, said sarcastically in your head. So you take your first sip of coffee. Shockingly, you almost spit it out. It's not coffee. It's herbal tea. Yuck. Gotta get that taste out of your mouth with that warm, toasted cinnamon raisin bagel. What? An everything bagel? Onions for breakfast? Not for you. So you brood in your car as you wait for the bridge to come down. You happen to glance down and see that you have toothpaste on your shirt. Wonderful. Again, said sarcastically in your head. You finally make it to work, late, and someone has taken your parking spot. The blackout has messed up the servers, so you can't get your computer running. Someone's put a stack of reports on your desk for you to review by the end of the day, but you can't review them without the computer. And thus is the beginning of a bad day. Having a bad day. We all have bad days, to varying degrees, perhaps not as bad as that one. Oh, and I don't drink coffee anyway, so. Allergic to caffeine, go figure. Oh, but we all joke about the threes, and you know what I'm talking about. Everything comes in threes. So after that flat tire, you wait with bated breath for the other two to appear. We get testy, snippy, sometimes downright rude when we're having a bad day. Jesus was no different. He also had bad days. There were the days when he was completely misunderstood, not only by the religious leaders, but even by his apostles, his close friends. One day, some people even tried to push him off a cliff. Another day, he got the terrible news that his friend and cousin, John the Baptist, had been beheaded. On other days, he was hounded by the crowds, and often for the wrong reasons. And one day, he was so exhausted, he fell asleep in a boat and didn't even wake up when the boat was rocked by a terrible storm. Then there was that certain Tuesday when he was arrested and tried unjustly. Thursday. And a certain Friday when he met his horrific death. Honestly, we don't have anything to complain about. But what brought about the events of today's readings? So a quick summary. It was all about purity. See, the Pharisees and the scribes from Jerusalem noticed that the disciples are eating without washing their hands first. Ritual hand washing. The issue is not germs. They didn't know about germs. It was about religious purity. Okay, can I just say yuck? You know, eating with dirty hands. For me, it has to do with the cleanliness part of it. Just saying. Back to the subject. The Pharisees asked Jesus why his disciples failed to observe the tradition of the elders by eating with defiled hands. In response, Jesus quotes the prophet Isaiah as a fitting description of the Pharisees. He replied, "Isaiah was right when he prophesied about you hypocrites. As it is written, these people honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. They worship me in vain. Their teachings are merely human rules. You have let go of the commandments of God and are holding on to human traditions." Basically, they're hypocrites or big fakes who honor God in word and not in substance. They also make up unnecessary commands for people to follow. Then Jesus talks about Moses and the command of God to honor their father and mother. Jesus argues that the Pharisees neglect this command when they deem any service they might offer their parents as a gift to God. In modern parlance, "Sorry, Mom, the money for the nursing home is going to God." Conclusion, the Pharisees disobey one of the Ten Commandments and make themselves feel good about it because they supposedly do it in the name of their own tradition. So obviously, ritual washing was a tradition of the elders, not a commandment of God. Really, is that what, commandment number 13b, or what is that? I don't know. Jesus tells the crowd to pay attention to another parable. Nothing external can enter a person and make him or her impure, but it's what comes out of a person that makes him or her impure. In private, the disciples are like, huh? So Jesus explains the wonders of human digestion. After he had left the crowd and entered the house, his disciples asked him about this parable. "Are you so dull?" he asked. "Don't you see that nothing that enters a person from the outside can defile them? For it doesn't go to their heart, but to their stomach, and then out the body." He went on, "What comes out of a person is what defiles them, for it is from within, out of a person's heart, that evil thoughts come. Sexual immorality, theft, murder, adultery, greed, malice, deceit, lewdness, envy, slander, arrogance, and folly. All these evils come from inside and defile a person." In other words, when something like food enters a person, it goes into the stomach, then into the toilet. How can the fact that you have to eat and then poop make you impure? Even Jesus can't resist a good potty joke. The significance of what he's saying is he's declaring that all food is clean. This may not seem like a big deal to most of us, But in the earliest days of Christianity, the question of whether non-Jewish converts to Christianity had to follow Jewish food laws was a hotly debated question. It's what's come out of your heart and not your rear end that makes you impure. So here we come to today's reading. So Jesus is tired. He's a little cranky. The Pharisees and scribes are getting on his nerves, and the disciples don't always get it. He needs some alone time. So he leaves the Galilee area and goes away, somewhere where he could be incognito, to the region of Tyre, a Gentile area. But he was becoming quite the celebrity, and his reputation preceded him. The woman who approaches Jesus breaks through every traditional barrier that should prevent her from doing so. She is a Gentile of Syrophoenician origin. In other words, she is implicitly impure, someone who lives outside of the land of Israel and outside of the law of Moses, and a descendant of the ancient enemies of Israel. If that weren't enough, she's also a woman, not accompanied by a husband or a male relative, who initiates a conversation with a strange man, another no-no. On top of all this, her daughter is possessed by demons. Could it get any worse? Now, although we're not told exactly how the demon affected her daughter, we can probably guess from other stories about demon-possessed people that it made her act in bizarre and antisocial ways. This woman and her daughter were not the kind of family most people would be likely to invite over for dinner. Any way you look at it, this woman is an outsider, and Jesus actually has the nerve to say as much to her face. As I said, Jesus was a little snippy. First, let the children eat all they want, he told her, for it is not right to take the children's bread and toss it to the dogs. Can we just say, whoa? Jesus' response is harsh. How could he say such a thing? Although he does appear to be quoting a bit of old Jewish folk wisdom, but that doesn't lessen its sting. Just to clarify, the children in his statement are the children of Israel. The dogs are understood to be all other people, including the Gentiles, who she is. Jesus is tired. Tired of people hounding him, demanding his healing, and he seems to be setting the limits of his mission, his call to serve his own people. In Matthew's version of the story, Jesus begins by saying, "I was sent only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel." When this persistent mother comes back at him with her clever response, "Even the dogs under the table eat the children's crumbs." Even the dogs get the children's crumbs. She is acknowledging her place in society, at least in Jesus' society. This woman had great spiritual insight. She wasn't asking Jesus to alter the way he is fulfilling the plan of God. She was simply asking for a crumb. Maybe seeing this woman's faith made a bad day just a little less for Jesus. Because Jesus can only agree. For such a reply, you may go. The demon has left your daughter. Bad days teach us something. They teach us compassion. Jesus had compassion on the woman. He has compassion on us. He had to endure terrible things, and he is able to have understanding on us. In each bad day, God has a lesson we can learn, silver lining and all, even if the lesson is, don't do that again. You've learned something. It takes discipline to overcome obstacles, discipline and faith in God that you can handle the bad days. In Hebrew, it says, all discipline at the moment seems painful rather than pleasant, but later yields the peaceful fruit of righteousness to those who have been trained by it. We don't usually see the positives on bad days, but perhaps on a deeper level, they are really good. They could be turning points for us. They may help us appreciate all the blessings we have that go beyond material goods. They may remind us how precious our loved ones are. They tell us our strength comes from God, who is always with us. I came across a song by Laurie Story. It's called Blessings. Here's a section of that song that can put a little different perspective on a bad day. What if your blessings come through raindrops? What if your healing comes through tears? What if 1,000 sleepless nights are what it takes to know you're near? What if trials of this life are your mercies in disguise? To finish off, I want to share something with you. I don't know who wrote it, but it's something I find helps when bad days come around. Never regret a day in your life. Good days give happiness, bad days give experience, worst days give lessons, and best days give memories. Let us pray. Lord, we all have bad days, and sometimes we think, why me? Help us to see that you're always with us and we never have to face things alone. Help us to see your blessings through raindrops and healing through tears. Help us to understand God's love and healing power. Know no ethnic, political, or social boundaries. Show us how to accept everyone as part of your flock. This we pray in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. Our next hymn is another one of my favorites, so I've been a little sneaky this week because I'm picking my favorite hymns. As the Deer Pants for the Water. And it's from Psalm 42.
Thank you.
have been richly blessed or called to share that blessing with the world. Let us pray together. Gracious God, we offer these gifts, thankful for opportunities to share, learn, and grow. People who are hurting, hungry, and fearful need your sustaining mercy. So we offer ourselves to become your hands and feet and heart to those who are in need. Empower us to be instruments of your love and vehicles of enduring compassion. In the name of Christ, we pray. Amen. Eternal God, God of each day, be with us in each of our days, we pray. Be with us in our seeing as we survey the world around us, as we look upon the people whose lives are bound up in our own. Let ours be a seeing that is not afraid to look at pain. Let ours be a seeing that can recognize the joy that is a certain sign of your active presence. God, be with us in our touching as we reach out to help and to hold. May ours be a touch that brings healing where there is hurt, that builds up and strengthens what is broken. Today, we pray especially for Neil Foss, husband of Sue Foss, who has been admitted to the hospital, is on the crisis list for placement in a facility. He will not be going home again. We pray for Roberta Cheevers, Pat Graham, Jenny Slingerlin, Alice Page, Sandy Sinclair, Nell Vanden Houten, Margaret Ballantyne. We also pray for Anthony Logan Sicanolfi, Pat Melville, Sandy and Paul Daughter and families, Betty Vanderberg and families, Marcia Tyrrell, Kathy, Leo, Timmy, William, and Beth. Bless them in their joyous times and in their challenging times. Be with us, O God, as we pray in silence, lifting to you our thanksgiving and our concerns for our world, our church, and ourselves. Lord, hear our prayers. Lord, be with us in our decisions, the choices that we make, the new directions we may venture into. May ours be choices that brings us closer to you, that demonstrate a faithful stewardship of the gifts and resources you have placed in our hands. God, be with us in our routines, in the dailiness of our living, in the common places of our lives. Bless to us the circle within which our lives are lived. By your Spirit, refresh us when the everyday seems a burden. Hear our prayers, O God, for we bring them in the name of Jesus Christ, our salvation. Amen. Our final hymn is, I Feel the Winds of God Today. Thank you. May the God of creation create in you a new reason for being. May the Christ who gives us peace provide a sense of peace for you and your loved ones. And may the Spirit who guides our lives guide your travels all the days of your life.
Stay.